Well, good morning, everybody. We're excited that you're here to worship with us. Would you stand? We're gonna get started with a little bit of a livelier song, try to wake up this cold weather that we got today. But I want to open with some prayer first and just commit the service to the Lord this morning. So let's pray. Father, we just come before you this morning, and Lord, we get to worship you anytime. You're always available to us, but how great it is that we can come together as a church body and worship you together. Lord, we love you, and we lift up your name this morning. We ask that you just be glorified. We pray that you'll be with Pastor Dane as he comes with the word. And Lord, just speak to us. Open our hearts and our minds. And we just invite the Holy Spirit to be here with us and to guide us. We give you glory, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing. Between us, by the cross you came and broke them down. You broke them down. There were chains around us, by your grace we are no longer bound. No longer bound. You call me out of the grave, you call me into the light. You call my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Darkness shaking, all the dead are coming back to life, back to life. Hear the song awaken, all creation singing, we're alive, 'cause you're alive. You call me out of the grave, you call me into the light, you call my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. And what a love we found, death can't hold us down. We shout it out, we're alive, 'cause you're alive. And what a love we found, down. We shout it out, we're alive, 'cause you're alive. And what a love we found, death can't hold us down. We shout it out, we're alive, 'cause you're alive. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater, your love is stronger, your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Amen. How exciting it is to be able to worship him this morning. We're going to sing now, It Is Well. It's a song that we sang. It's been a little while since we've sang it, but it's a beautiful song. And I just love the words that go through it. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. And I know some of you may have things going on right now, prayer requests, praises, things that are on your heart and on your mind. And I just invite you as we sing this song to just give those things over to the Lord. And just rest and trust in him and just know that it truly is well. It's all well. So let's sing with Kara.
quaked before, moved by the sound of his voice. Seas that are shaken and stirred can be cold and broken from my regard. And through it all, through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well with me. Far be it from me to not believe, even when my eyes can't see. And this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. And through it all, through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well. It is well. So let go, my soul, and trust. And it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. Through it all,
Amen. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning, our song shall rise to thee. Let's sing that famous hymn. Singing. You guys can be seated.
Good morning, church. Good morning. Yes, I know it's the 1st of May and it feels like it's the 1st of February, but that's okay. We're going to get along all right. But thank you to our worship team for leading us in worship. That second song actually hit me pretty hard today. Basically, the classic week where I thought, okay, I'm going to take this big, deep breath. You know, the Easter season is crazy, and the weeks before that were crazy. And so this week, I've got Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday all planned out, and it's just going to be a deep breath, and then my world gets rocked. And a reminder of that song, okay, that's all right. It's all right. I've still got that foundation. It is well. It is well, even though my earth's been rocked. And I've got that foundation that I can cling to. And so I appreciate being able to sing that this morning and remind myself. If you brought your Bibles or you have a Bible on your phone or Bible on your app, go ahead and turn to Luke 24. We're going to be getting there here in just a moment. But couple of quick things. Last Sunday, the Sunday after Easter, we had a great opportunity to have a baptismal service. A baptism, basically, a public profession of those who have said, yep, I've trusted in Christ. I desire to live for Christ. I want to publicly make that known. And just congratulations to Ruth Dunham and Ella Hodgel and Cedric Auberg, who made that decision. So proud and proud of you for making that decision, and continue to pray with them. And then on the screen, you see something a little bit unusual, but anyway, on Easter Sunday, I quoted someone, a Prince of Priests or Spurgeon, and basically it was this hope. It's a win-win situation if you're a follower of Christ. If we live, Jesus will be with us. If we die, we will be with Jesus. And I made the offhand comment, hey, wouldn't that be a good one to put on a t-shirt or a mug? And of course, out in the audience, there were some children of Stacy Rousen, who is the owner of Lakefront Living, and they sort of looked at her, and they and so about 2 days after last Sunday, or after Easter Sunday, I had this mug sitting on my outside my office door, and so a big thank you for that. Tulip time coming up. Make sure you visit the E-Free booth. The booth is out there for a reason, to remind you that we're right by the post office, so you can look it up. But if you want a really good walking taco, or we have people that stay up all night smoking meat for smoked meat nachos. And so either walking tacos, smoked meat nachos, or something else, we've got it for you. And then last, out in the lobby, there's a baby bottle. You grab one of those. It's basically to help support Pathways Appella, who helps with pregnant women, also provides ultrasounds free of charge for those who need it. And so basically you grab a bottle, you fill it up with change, and you bring it back, and that's one of the ways that they can do that. Hey, let's pray. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I just come to you and just give you thanks that you can be that anchor. You can be that solid foundation, both in the good times and the bad times of life. And Lord, I just praise you and just ask you that you would be with us this morning. Lord, some of us have been here for all 30 years that this church has existed. Some of us have been attending church many, many years. Others really don't know a whole lot about what this Christianity, what Jesus is all about. Holy Spirit, I ask as this very weak vessel preaches this morning, that I might be able to just simply open your word, proclaim it, and Holy Spirit, that for every individual here, every one of them so unique, so different from one another, may you be able to speak to their hearts and minds. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, well, because I want to keep expanding your minds, and because as I look out at the people at Liberty Free, I see a very highly intelligent bunch of people. I'm going to show a word on the screen, and I'm going to ask you to tell me what does this word mean? What is this word? Can you tell me what this word is? It's pronounced triptych. Triptych. I didn't know it until 3 days ago myself. But the official definition from Merriam-Webster's dictionary is a triptych is a picture such as an altarpiece or carving that comes in three different sections or panels. A second definition is something composed of or presented in three different parts or sections, like a trilogy. Okay, give me some examples. Back in the 12th and 14th centuries, there was usually a wooden type of, they called it triptych, that would be on the altar. And then all of a sudden, when stained glass became popular, many stained glass windows did what was called the triptych, where you'd have a scene on the same scene on three different stained glass windows. And then there was wall hangings on a triptych style. These are very popular today. Now you go to a person's apartment or their home, and they've got the same scene, but it's in three different sections, and it's on their wall. And then Addy Addickson, I butchered this person's name, decided that he would do something very unusual with triptychs. He took photos of different people and decided to combine them in different ways. And you're like, okay, how would you like to be having that on your wall, staring at you all day long? But evidently, he sold quite a bit. He sold quite a bit, and so it's just very interesting. So anyway, Luke chapter 24, which we're going to look at portions of it today, would basically be best described as a resurrection triptych. Basically, it describes Easter Sunday following, according to the historian Luke. Luke wanted to make sure that people had in their hands an accurate historical record of Jesus and his life. And in Luke chapter 24, we begin the chapter with the resurrection of Christ, Easter Sunday. And then you see basically three different scenes: the resurrection, the road to Emmaus, and then you also see when Jesus appears to his disciples. And there's three common themes in every one of these three scenes. Three different accounts. In all three scenes, you witness the same sequence. There's shock and unbelief. You say that Jesus is alive? Really? Is that really the case? And then all of a sudden, you see reminder of what Jesus has said. Like to remind you what Jesus said. We'd like to remind you what the Bible said. And then after they suddenly realize, oh, it's true, he's alive, then basically their lives are changed and you see joy and worship and witness. So there's shock and unbelief. There's a reminder, well, this is what he said. And then there's joy, worship, and witness. And I'm going to focus on scenes number 2 and 3 primarily. And so I want you to do is place yourself in each of these triptychs, the second and the third. Imagine that you're there. And then we're going to apply it. The first one is the resurrection. We're going to jump over that. That's Easter Sunday, Easter morning. And then it says in verse 13, the very day, two of them were going to. So this is the same day when the empty tomb was discovered. And all of a sudden, something very unusual takes place. It says, that very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. And while they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near, and he went with them. All of a sudden, the resurrected Christ appears. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. They didn't know it was Jesus. And he said to them, what is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk? And they stood there and they were looking sad. And then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened here in these past few days? I chuckle when I read that. The very one who was the centerpiece of the past few days, the one who everybody yelled Hosanna, glory to God in the highest when he came into Jerusalem, the one who hung on the cross, and now the one who had risen from the dead, is the one that this person asks, aren't you aware of what's happened? It had to bring a little bit of a smile. Jesus plays along, and he asks, what things? And they said to him, well, concerning this Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death, and they crucified him. We had hoped he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it's now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb earlier this morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb, found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. So there you have the shock and unbelief. And now number 2, a reminder of what Jesus has said from Jesus himself. Verse 25, and Jesus said to them, O foolish ones, slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them all that the scriptures had said concerning himself. And they drew near to a village to which they were going, and he acted as if he were going further. But they argued him strongly, saying, stay with us, for it is towards evening, and the day is now far spent. So he went to stay with them, and when they were at the table with them, he took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they finally recognized him. And then he vanished from their sight. And they said to each other, did not our hearts burn within us while we talked to us on the road, while he opened us up to the scriptures? Joy, worship, and witness. Oh, the aha moment. That was him. Then we go to scene three. They go and report to the disciples what had happened to them, and then all of a sudden Jesus appears to the whole gang. Luke 24, beginning with verse 36. As they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, peace to you. They were startled and frightened, thought he was a spirit, a ghost. And he said to them, why are you troubled, and why do doubts rise in your hearts? Look at my hands. Look at my feet. That it is I. It is me. Touch me. See, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands. He showed them his feet. And while they were still, disbelieved for joy and were marveling at these things, he says, by the way, do you have anything to eat? They gave him a piece of broiled fish. He took it and he ate it before them. I'm not a ghost. I'm the resurrected Christ, resurrected physically. Look at the nails in my hands, the nails in my feet. And I'll show you that I'm not a ghost. I'll take some fish and I'll eat it. So there you have the shock and unbelief. You have the reminder from Christ. Then he said to them, these are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, and that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled. And then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. So there we have it. We have the resurrected Christ, those who were very, very close to him, still struck and shocked by what had taken place, thinking this is going to be this Messiah that's just going to overtake the Roman Empire. But instead, they crucified him. And they forgot how constantly this Jesus said, here's what's going to happen. They're going to arrest me. They're going to crucify me. And they're going to kill me. And then 3 days later, I'm going to rise from the grave. He constantly communicated to them, but let's be careful that we probably would have done the same. Let me make some observations. Number one, how did Jesus address their unbelief? Did he wow them with more miracles? Did he put on a show? No, what he did is, let's go back to the scriptures. Let's even go back to the Old Testament. Let's go back to the law, the first five books of the Bible. Let's go to the prophets, the ones who prophesied about me. Let's go to the Psalms. Basically, let's go to the entire Old Testament, and I will show you from the scriptures this is what was supposed to happen. So he went to the scriptures. You see this three different times that he revealed himself. And so basically what it tells me is the value and necessity and the revelation of the Scriptures. The Word of God, the Bible. Verse 32, they said, "Did not our hearts burn within us while He talked to us on the road while He opened up the Scriptures?" There is not a part of the Scriptures that does not bear witness to the promised Messiah, this Jesus. The whole Bible is about God's plan. God's plan, because you and I, every single one of us, have rebelled against God in thought, in mind, in motive, in behavior. We've all rebelled. There's no one that can stand up, raise their hand, and say, "Well, I'm an exception. I've been goody two-shoes all my life." You might be moral, you might be the opposite. But even in our morality, we rebel against God because we think that we're able to earn ourselves into God's favor. And so the whole Bible talks about God's plan to reconcile and redeem His people. And His plan was this Jesus. This Jesus who would go on the cross and pay the penalty for my sins and your sins. And that plan is laid out all through the Scriptures. It's the thread of the Scriptures. Number two, maybe you're here today and you're very much like the people in these three scenes. Maybe you're like the women at the tomb. Maybe you're like those who are on the road to Emmaus. Those of you, or those disciples that were in that room. Maybe it's like you. Maybe it's like me. You attended church. You have attended church week after week after week, year after year after year. You have heard the Bible preached. You've gone to Sunday school. You've gone to youth group. You've been encouraged and pleaded with. Trust in Christ. Trust in Christ. Trust in Christ. But until now, your mind and your heart have been stubborn and resistant to the Savior. So you've got an intellectual, mental understanding of who Jesus is. It's been pounded into your brain week after week, month after month. Maybe that's you. That was me. But you said, "Nope, I'm not going to give my life to Christ." That's my story. Now, it was unfortunate that I went to church every Sunday, but for those many years growing up, there was no, at least from how I understood, a call, you must trust in Christ. It's not religion. It's not Christianity. It's a relationship with this Jesus who died for you. I finally heard that my junior year of high school at an FCA conference. And it became extremely clear to me that I needed to respond to this Jesus. And amongst 700 other high schoolers at this FCA retreat, I said, "No, not doing that." Isn't it interesting that 4 or 5 years later, when I was in college, I was standing before those 700 and 800 high schoolers and told them I was where you were at a few years back. And I said no. And I pleaded with them, letting them know what a grave mistake that was and how I'm just so thankful that eventually, through a lot of circumstances, I gave my life to Christ. Maybe that's you today. My message to you is Christ is available and willing, no matter who you are, no matter what you've done, no matter what your background. You may be from an unchurched background. Christ is standing there and saying, "Hey, I don't care who you are, what you've done. I'm available right now. Give your life to me. give your life to me, turn your life around, and follow me from this point forward. My main focus today, though, is the verses that I've skipped in that last scene. And it's to be a reminder to us who are followers of Christ about God's heart. God's heart is not only to you as an individual. God's plan was not only to send Christ for you personally, but He has a much, much bigger desire. Let's read that, verses 45 through 49. Then Jesus opened their minds to understand the Scriptures, and He said to them, "Thus it is written, the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in His name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. And you are witnesses to these things, and behold, I am sending you the promise of My Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." Basically, Christ is communicating, yes, I was crucified on that cross. I died and I rose again to prove that I'm the real deal. And I died for you, but I also died for a much bigger picture. I have died so that people from every nation, every tongue, every tribe would also be able to hear this good news and respond. And that's why He says in this, I call it Luke's Great Commission. See, we're familiar with the one in Matthew, the Great Commission there, many of us. But this is Luke's Great Commission, and He says the same thing. He says that repentance and forgiveness of sin should be proclaimed in His name to all nations, beginning right here, beginning in Jerusalem where they were at. And my response, follower of Christ, is if God's heart is to extend His glory and praise and salvation to the nations, to the peoples, then there should be a stirring in every single one of our hearts as followers of Christ to possess a heart that goes beyond me. What Jesus has done for me. It should extend from me to, there's a whole lot of people out there around the world that still need to hear this message. John Piper writes this, "God is pursuing with omnipotent passion a worldwide purpose of gathering joyful worshipers for Himself from every tribe, every tongue, and every people and every nation. God has an inexhaustible enthusiasm for the supremacy of His name among all the nations. Therefore, let us bring our own affections, our own desires, our own passion into line with His. And for the sake of His name, let us renounce the quest for worldly comforts and join in His global purpose. If we do this, God's omnipotent commitment to His name will be over us just like a banner, and we will not lose. In spite of many tribulations, the mission must go forward." Missions is not the ultimate goal of the church. Worship is. Mission exists because in many nations, worship does not. The Great Commission is first to delight yourself in the Lord and then to declare, "Let the nations be glad as well and sing for joy." In this way, God will be glorified from the beginning to the end, and worship will empower the missionary enterprise until the coming of the Lord. And then we will see Revelations 15, verses 3 through 4 take place. "Great and amazing are your deeds, O Lord God the Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the nations. Who will not fear, O Lord, and who will not glorify your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship you, for your righteous acts have been revealed." One of our four values, if you go out in the lobby, you'll see the brand new four values listed on one of the things in the lobby. One of our values is outreach, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ locally, nationally, and globally. And then we've got measures. which are not to be a checklist, but they're supposed to be read as, how am I doing here? And one of our three measures is this. We only have three. One of our three measures is this: intentional relationships with your neighbors and around the world. And here's three questions that help us to understand how are we doing. Am I intentionally interacting with others to lead them towards Christ? Am I sacrificially giving in all aspects of my life for God's glory? And am I personally engaged in sharing Christ, not only with my neighbor, but with the nations? And that doesn't necessarily mean that you go by yourself, that you go full time. But how are you helping to fulfill that in your own life, either by going or by staying here and allowing others to do the same? In verses 46 through 49, it basically says that his commission is for those of us who are followers of Christ to be witnesses in our neighborhoods, right here in Jerusalem. Pella's our Jerusalem, Knoxville's our Jerusalem, Soli's our Jerusalem, Otley's our Jerusalem. Around the world through the power of the Holy Spirit. And there's different ways, different training, different experiences. We have a goal set that in the next 5 years we will double the number of short-term missionary trips that we allow people to go on. Why? Because I know that when you go, whether that means to Des Moines, Iowa, or that means to India, like I do every other year, that your eyes are opened to A, the need, and B, what can happen. It's very interesting. I got an email this week from the National Office of the Evangelical Free Church, which we are a part of that movement. And they're celebrating the 100th anniversary of the first Evangelical Free Church missionary to go to Congo. He went in 1922. He was fresh out of college and basically wanted to go to some place in Africa. And he chose Congo. And he got there and he learned the language. And as he learned the language, he was able to share this good news with the peoples there. And as time went on, more and more missionaries joined him in these efforts. And one of the things that they had a heart for was there's horrible health conditions here in this area of the Congo with all these small tribes. So we're going to establish a hospital, which came to be known as Tondala Hospital. And eventually, doctors and nurses who had been trained here in the United States says, you know what? There's a need over there. I'm going to go. And it's very interesting that several of those doctors, some of those doctors and some of those nurses were right from here in Iowa. A little town called Meriden, Iowa has two free churches, not because they got mad at each other and split, but because there's one in the little teeny tiny town and there's one outside called Oakdale. And out of these two churches, a doctor and a couple of others went to Congo. And all of a sudden, they started to see hundreds of these individuals give their lives to Christ. And that was 100 years ago. And then they went through some political unrest back in the 90s. And the major decision was, we've got to clear everybody out of there. All Americans. And even after that occurred, the church thrived because they had been training. They had a Bible Institute. They had other things that they had established to help train followers in how to equip others. And today, we celebrate the 100th anniversary of this people group, this nation that had never been reached before. But in 1922, one individual decided, I'm going to go and make a change. And so what a glorious story that is. And in the weeks to come, we're going to be, number one, trying to encourage you to set your mind, set your heart on whenever we have the opportunity as a church to go somewhere, whether that be Des Moines, Iowa for a day, or to India for 15 days, that you'll at least say, you know what, I need to at least pray about this. I need to at least pray about this. And one of the opportunities we have in October as a church is to go up to the Twin Cities to a training session, which we're the only ones for that weekend. You sign up, only one church. And it's called Engage Global. And basically our goal is you go with an old man like me to the Twin Cities on a Friday, Saturday, and Sunday to this Engage Global. And what you will experience is you will experience teaching about what's God's heart for the nations. Let's expand our hearts. Let's expand our minds. But it's also going to be very, very practical. They're going to be teaching you about different nations. They're going to be teaching you about different cultures. And then you'll actually go to two marketplaces that are predominantly of a single nation or a single type of people. And you're not there to share face-to-face Christ with them. You're there to find out more about who they are, so that you can get a bigger understanding and a bigger heart for what's out there, even in our own country. We've got flyers out at the Welcome Center if you're interested in at least perusing it. We're going to give you a whole lot more information in the weeks to come. And because we're very, very committed to this, basically the Missions Commission has said, hey, we're going to invest in this. And they're going to give at least $50 of the $250 registration fee you don't have to pay for. The church is going to provide for that. So it's going to be a Friday. It's going to require Friday, Saturday, and Sunday of you, a specific time in October. But there's going to be 20 of us, me included, that are going to go up there and expand our minds, expand our hearts about the world. Usually we have an elder that comes up and prays, who's not an elder besides me. But whenever we partake of communion, I have the privilege of leading us in prayer. And so I'm going to pray for about what we just heard from God's word, but I'm also going to expand that prayer in sort of a family prayer, a liberty prayer as well. And as I pray, would you please stand? Just stand, and let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I just come to you and give you praise, number one, for your word. Because, Lord, just like your word did for those people in Luke chapter 24, Lord, your word just expands my mind and my heart. It gives me insight to how great you are, how majestic you are. It gives me insight to your love and your mercy and your grace that you extend to everybody, but it also gives me insight to your justice and your holiness and your righteousness. Lord, it opens my mind constantly. It doesn't matter how much seminary training I've had. Your word opens my heart and my mind constantly of the depth and the width and the breadth of your love and what you were willing to do to reconcile your people, completely undeserving people, to yourself. So I thank you for that. Lord, I pray that we would be people of the word. And Lord, even from someone who's seminary trained, there's portions of the scripture that I read even now, and I'm like, I don't fully understand this. But I keep plugging away, day after day, week after week. And Lord, there's always a nugget of truth that is new and fresh to me. Lord, I pray that you would give us a hunger for your word. And Heavenly Father, I pray that you'd give us a hunger for Jesus as well, because Christianity is not a religion. It's a relationship that needs to deepen and grow. And so, Father, I pray that no matter where we're at, whether we've not made a decision for Christ at this point or whether we've been a follower of Christ for years, Lord, that you would allow us to grow more passionate about following Jesus. Heavenly Father, I pray for those in our church family. Lord, we sang that song, It Is Well. And just as Joe mentioned, there's people here in this congregation that are hurting. They're going through all sorts of different scenarios in their lives. Each one of you unique, but each one of them very hard. Lord, I just pray that they would rely upon you as their anchor and that you would be with them. And Heavenly Father, I especially pray for Shane Beyer. Lord, there's so many unknowns still. And Lord, as he goes to Mayo, I pray that you would give the doctors and the specialists and everybody involved just an extra measure of wisdom and knowledge in knowing how to tackle the issues that he's facing. Lord, I continue to pray your grace and your mercy and comfort on Karen Dykstra as she goes through yet another round of chemo. It's just heartbreaking. I pray, but yet she is so firmly founded upon you that she is actually an encouragement to other people. Thank you for her faith. Lord, for others, we pray for Tulip Time. Lord, that even in the smallest of ways, as we're talking with people, they might see something different in our lives. And Lord, that we might be able to pray for them after we've connected with them. Lord, I just thank you for what Christ has done. As we go to the Lord's table, I pray as well that our hearts and minds, as your word says, that we would be prepared, that we would have examined our hearts to partake. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You can go ahead and have a seat. In Matthew 26, right before Jesus is to be betrayed, arrested, taken into custody, abused and beaten unmercifully, and then taken to the cross, he was with his disciples celebrating the Passover as every Jewish person did at that point in time, and he instituted what was called the Lord's Supper, the Lord's table. And basically, it was a very interesting thing, one of the things that he said. As we talk about the nations and the tribes, he said this. He said, as he did this, he said, as they were eating, Jesus took bread and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples. And he said, take, eat, this is my body. And then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, this is the point. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. He's referring to the marriage supper of the Lamb. When Christ returns and gathers his people into glory, and there will be a great feast, which is described in the scripture as being people from every tribe, every nation, every language, every tongue, around the same table, worshiping and praising God for what he has done through Jesus Christ. And so even as we participate in this, number one, we look back. Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of what I've done for you when I went to the cross. But it's also to make us look forward in anticipation of that day when, like he says, I'm not going to share this cup with you until that day when I celebrate it anew with you in my Father's kingdom, as every tribe, nation, tongue, and people partakes of this cup with me, those who have chosen to follow Christ. And so I'd ask that you would do the same thing this morning, that as we partake of the bread and the cup, that you will, number one, look back, do this in remembrance of Christ, but number two, that you would also realize that there's going to be a day when you and I receive this cup, and it is going to be multi-ethnic, and it's going to be beautiful. Just remember that. Think about that. What a glorious time that will be. We're going to hand out. You just grab. Actually, what you'll see is there's one cup stacked on top of another. At the bottom is the bread. At the top is the cup. Hold those until all of us have been served, and then we'll give you instructions on how to partake. You'll see little slips of paper extended out of a few of the cups in each tray. Those are simply for those who are gluten-free. If you don't need gluten-free, don't take one of the cups that has the piece of paper. Reserve those for those who have that need. Those who are going to serve, go ahead and come forward. But basically, we're just simply going to do what Jesus asked us to do on a regular basis. We're simply going to partake of the bread, partake of the cup in remembrance of him, and also looking forward to having this experience in his presence someday in the future. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you've told us to examine our hearts before we partake, and so we do that now. Lord, every single one of us has sin issues. We confess those to you. And your word says that when we confess our sins to you honestly, with pure motives, that you are more than willing to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from our unrighteousness. And so, Lord, as we hold this cup and wait for everybody to be to receive the cup, we do that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus, your love and has come one step closer, I will trust that you will never let me go. Jesus, your love has won me over all my trust. It has found no other. And I will declare the beauty of the Lord, and nothing compares to the beauty of the Lord. Jesus, your love, it takes my breath away. Now I'm living every day for the beauty of the Lord. Jesus, your love has come one step closer, I will trust that you'll never let me go. Jesus, your love has won me over. Lord,
Jesus, your love, it takes my breath away. And Jesus, your love, it takes my breath away. And Jesus, your love, it takes my breath away. And Jesus, your love, it takes my breath away. And Jesus, your love, it takes my breath away. And Jesus, your love. Jesus, your love, it takes my breath away. Jesus, your love, it takes my breath away. And I will declare the beauty of the Lord. And nothing compares to the beauty of the Lord. But Jesus, your love, it takes my breath away. Now I'm living every day for the beauty of the Lord.
As I said earlier, I believe that we are full of people here that are skilled. And basically what you need to do now is separate the two cups. And Jesus first took the bread and he broke it and he said, this bread is to remind us of his body, which was broken for us, referring to what would happen to his body before and during his time on the cross, where he basically had his body mutilated by evil people. And so let's do this in remembrance of what Christ was willing to do, not only physically, but take our sins upon him as we remember through the bread. Let's do so at this time. And the cup is to remind us of the blood that Christ was willing to shed, so that you and I could experience forgiveness of our sins, which is necessary for us to be in a relationship with God. And it only comes through the sacrifice that Christ was willing to make. And so we remember by this cup the blood that Christ was willing to shed, so that you and I could experience forgiveness of sins. Let's remember. Would you please go ahead and stand? I'm going to ask one of our elders to close our time at the table in prayer.
Lord, we thank you that we can celebrate Easter, a resurrected. The cross is empty. The tomb is empty. You didn't stay there. Your word proclaims it. You are alive. You live in us. May we live with that hope, with that joy, to share with others. We thank you for this time. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let's sing together.
Well, it's a big week, tulip time. And as we were saying, the battle does belong to the Lord. It is well. You know, we can give all of our concerns, all of our worries over to him. Let's go out into the week this week and let's proclaim his name, give him honor, give him glory as we live. But let's sing together this last song, Battle Belongs. When all I see is the battle, and you see my victory, I see is the mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me.
lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, and you see the cross, God, you see the empty tomb. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. So when I fight, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. And I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Yeah. How about an amen that's good and bold there? All right, hey, amen, all right, good. A couple of high school announcements. Number one, we don't have Sunday school. We usually take a break during the summertime. However, high school students, you are to report to the kitchen. You are to report to the kitchen right after worship, and we'd appreciate that. And secondly, for those of you who are parents and those of you high schoolers who are graduating, yeah, it's May. And in 2 weeks from today is our graduate recognition Sunday, where we allow you to have a table. And I'm just forewarning parents that you are able to put pictures and stuff like that at the table. So you've got 2 weeks to get ready for that, simply because I reminded you. So anyway, good to have you here this morning. Let me close with this. This is from Revelation. This is sort of a picture of what's to come for those who have placed their trust in Christ. And after this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number. No one could number, and they came from every nation, from all tribes and people and languages, and they stood before the throne And they stood before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, with palm branches in their hands. And they cried out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits on the throne, and to the Lamb, Christ." And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they all fell on their faces before the throne and they worshiped God. And they said, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever." And like they responded, they said, "Amen." God bless you. Thanks for being here this morning. Please greet one another as you leave this morning, and take some time to get to know some people that you don't know.